That was Andrea Pedro, and she just played a piece by Franz Liszt called Liebestraum, which is German for Dreams of Love. Andrea is a friend of mine from Kwantlen, so I asked her to play for this concert. She was happy to oblige, which we're all very happy about.
So, good evening. The next piece we'll be performing for you is Pie Jesu from Andrew Lloyd Webber's Requiem. This Requiem was written to honor his father, who sadly passed away in 1982. It's considered his most personal composition and the only fully completed classical work that he had written. Its beautiful, simple melody will be represented in the high soprano with a rich low register in the viola and also accompanied by organ.
We are going to play a sonata, Johann Sebastian Bach. It's the sonata number 5 in E minor. I have some information here. In the book it says here, when in November 1717 Bach accepted a summons of Duke Leopold of Anhalt-Köthen, it was a sequestered life in comparison with Weimar, where he worked before. That the little residence had to offer him, he had no cantatas to write, no organ to play for, and this is the interesting part. The Reformed Church scorned the sound of organs and festive pomp. Yes. Nevertheless, the art-loving court at Köthen supplied him with a host of most fertile duties of a different nature, and freed from the claims of the church, he was able to dedicate his whole creative force to the composition of instrumental chamber music, of which we are very thankful. Sonata number 5, we play 3 movements. It has 4, but we thought it a little too long, so we play 3 movements. Thank you.
The next piece is an organ solo. This is by Buxtehude. Buxtehude was a German organist in the northern part of Germany, and he was one of the people that had a great influence on Johann Sebastian Bach. It's one of the composers that lived after him, and there was a lot of interaction, especially on the musical side, between the two, and Bach picked up quite a bit of the ideas from Buxtehude. The piece that you're going to hear is a prelude, but you will hear different ideas and different things in that piece. It starts off like a fantasia. It's an improvisation almost, how it starts with. Very free, something that you say, well, where is he going? All over the place. And halfway the piece, he introduces a fugue. And a fugue is a one single melody, and that has a repeating note. You will hear that repeating note coming back, and then it comes back in different voices. So it will be in the pedal, it will be in the hands, it will be all over the place. Once he's done with that fugue, because you can only so long keep on going with that, then he continues and he creates a postlude. A postlude. He finishes it off. He closes the piece, and you will find a totally different character towards the end of the piece. So it is called a prelude, but the prelude has actually three parts. The first one is a very free improvisation almost. Second part is that fugue, and once the fugue is done, he does a few interesting things, and then you get to the end, and he ends it quite nicely.
Thank you.
Okay, and now for something completely different. Next in your program you'll see is a piece called Lamentations of Jeremiah by someone you've probably never heard of, by the name of Milton Barnes. Now, this is our token Canadian and modern piece in the program today. Milton Barnes was Canadian, and his dates are in the program, I believe. He died in 2001 of a heart attack, I think. But he wrote this piece shortly after World War II, while he was in Italy. And World War II was very hard hit by Italy, and he was visiting a little town that had been particularly badly ravaged by the war. And there he saw a painting by Rembrandt. And this piece, if you look in the music, it says at the end, it's a rhapsodic tone poem based on the Rembrandt painting of Jeremiah pondering the destruction of Jerusalem. And a tone poem is, well, it's exactly that. It's a poem. It's trying to express an emotion or various emotions through music. And in this case, he's trying to express lamenting. And if you listen to it that way, there's no music, there's no time signature, no key signature, which means don't try to find a beat because there isn't one. What I'm trying to do with this is to sound, what the composer tried to do when he wrote this is he's trying to make it sound like a lament, like a person lamenting great destruction, which is what this painting, this is the Rembrandt painting up here, which is what he was inspired by this. And also, if you read the Book of Lamentations, there's a lot in there about the destruction of Jerusalem. So that's what this piece is about. Don't particularly want to say enjoy, but hope you appreciate the piece.
Thank you.
That was Amy Oliverio on the piano. Thank you for accompanying Karen. They both study at Kwantlen as well. So I thought it's good to mention her name. It's now time for refreshment, coffee, and other things besides here in the church hall. So if you go out and you go through the doors there, then I hope to see you back in about 15, 20 minutes. Thank you. the following piece in your program is written by two people. Actually, if you look at the, I wrote it in there. Yes, so Albanini is the person that is usually credited, and his name is also on the top of this piece if we look at the music. However, the people that study music, they found out that he is not the composer. Albanini lived like a long time ago, and Remo Giazzotto, he found a few bars of old music that was written by Albanini, and he wrote this whole piece. And he wrote not his own name there, but he wrote the original, what he thought was the old man was long dead, because I thought it gives more credibility to the piece. And yes, people thought, oh wow, this is a real old piece. For the first time you ever found a piece back, wow, really good. And everyone embraced it, and it became really, really popular. And only a number of years ago, the people really studied it and said, well, there's no original. We can't find anything. We have only a few fragments. But the real composer, what we really believe, is the guy that found it. And he just made us believe. Well, so at the end, if you go on the internet right now, you can't find this piece as a free piece. It's not allowed to be free because now the composer is not dead for so many years, and the composer just is dead for a couple of years. So it is still protected by the Copyright Act, and you still have to pay for this music if you want to get it, because it is not the original composer that everyone believed it is. So wasn't it an interesting thing that was discovered? It's for violin and organ. We're going to play it. It's a slow piece. I think you will recognize the piece. Just sit back and relax.
Thank you.
We didn't agree on who was going to say something when, so there's nobody here that picks up the microphone, so I do this. The next song is the national anthem of Israel, and we had to do some preparation in order to make this work for all of us. So in the readings, what I did, I came across Wikipedia. Wikipedia has sometimes good stuff on the internet. And in this case, it was a recording, and you can find it too. It's a recording of the people that the Jews in one of the concentration camps when they were liberated in 1945, and they were singing this particular song when they were liberated. And it is a song, it's called Hope, and it testifies about the hope that we have in Jesus Christ, but they still have that, that he is coming. But it's about the hope, and that hope, you can hear it in their voices, that God is faithful, and that it was not the end. And that is really, that recording is really emotional, without instruments, of course, very rough voices. But that same song is now the national anthem of Israel, and we want to finish that with that tonight.